Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the first meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2023. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Are the committee in agreement to take items 6 and 7 in private? Agenda item 6 is a discussion on the cross-party group system, and agenda item 7 is a discussion on correspondence that we've received from the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. Are we in agreement? Thank you. Agenda item 2, and can I welcome Colin Beattie, MSP, to this meeting. Colin is the proposed convener of a proposed group on space, I think. Yes. Can I invite Colin to make an opening statement about the intentions of the group and the interests that you've had about it?
Thank you, convener, and I'd like to thank the committee for the opportunity to say a few words this morning in support to this cross-party group. It's really all rather exciting. I know you'll have read the group's purpose, and in that you'll have noticed that we talk about the importance of the space sector to the economy of Scotland, but also to the wider UK. And in that regard, I've been in touch with the chair of the Westminster APPG on space, and we've agreed that, you know, going forward we will liaise and do the best we can to have a joined up approach on this. But I think there's very little awareness just how much the space industry contributes to the Scottish economy and how we can help develop this going forward. Now, at the moment, according to the industry, there are 97 companies involved in Scotland, both Scottish SMEs and rather larger companies. And if you look at the list of non-MSP members of the group, you'll see Airbus, Lockheed Martin, you'll see the UK Government's Department for International Trade, and a number of others, including universities and so on. And there's a number of others who are in the process of moving down the road of signing up as well. Scotland's home to a fifth of the jobs in the UK in space. 52% of nanosatellites in the world are produced in Glasgow. So we have a huge commitment to the space industry. Now, alongside this, the number of space businesses have increased by 65% since 2016. And that's evident in the numbers we're seeing, and it's still expanding. We're leading the way on space industry. For example, the UK Astronomy Technology Centre, based at the Royal Observatory in Edinburgh, is a national centre of excellence for the development of scientific instrumentation and facilities for ground and space-based astronomy. And the Phoenix-based Mangata Networks, described as an innovative satellite-enabled cloud services company, has said Ayrshire will be the centre for its R&D activities, as well as satellite manufacturing, which will increase, of course, the proportion of satellites produced in Scotland. And they will be creating 575 jobs at the new Space Research and Development Facility. Now, from astronomy to pure science to manufacturing to launch to data use and application, it's a complex sector with a wide-ranging and transformational impact. And this exciting work that's taking place in Scotland needs a platform for discussion and a platform to highlight to parliamentarians the world-leading changing innovations that are happening on our doorstep in Scotland. Now, since submitting the form, there's two other organisations have signed up, Skyrora and Global Trek Aviation. And Skyrora, I have a particular feeling for because they're in my constituency and I have stood there beside the rockets, and it really is impressive. So, you know, this is exciting. This really is exciting. So we have, at the moment, 23 of the 97 organisations signed up, and we're in discussion with many more. I'm also pleased that the establishment of the CPG has attracted attention from the different political parties. It's rare, I think, to have four different political parties with representatives signed up for a cross-party group. These days, you struggle to get two or three to do that, but still, we're good. It demonstrates the interest and the need for the cross-party group, and I think CPG will strengthen and go from, you know, increase in size. Talking about possible duplications or overlaps, the CPG on aviation used to touch on space. However, this appeared from the minutes to be very rare. And it didn't really touch on the space in the space industry in the breadth and depth, given the huge scale of the space industry. And they seemed to focus more on the large commercial airlines, airport and travel agent groups. So bringing this focus to space, this huge growing industry in Scotland, is, I think, tremendously important. The sector simply warrants a dedicated CPG, as no other CPGs fully capture this sector. Now, I'm aware there's a large number of CPGs, which is why I'm here. And I've been careful myself not to overly commit myself to a large number of CPGs this session, so I can keep that priority and focus on the CPGs that I'm a convener of and member of. And I believe that the members who have signed up to this CPG will no doubt have made the same considerations. The CPG has got three deputy conveners and myself as convener, which ensures that the proper support can be given to the CPG and allows capacity for other MSPs to step in should someone not be available. We plan to meet about four times a year, more or less like any other CPGs, but we will be a bit flexible on that depending. You know, we're dealing with a lot of people and a complex and wide industry, so we'll be a wee bit flexible on that. But I think given the support both within the Parliament and from the industry groups, our link up with the Westminster APPG, as I say, we've even got UK government departments as members. So that's probably a first. So I think there's a very strong case here for this CPG, and I hope the committee will give it due consideration.
Thank you very much, Colin, for that. And it was nice to see, and I mean this in the most polite way, the almost juvenile excitement about Skyrora signing up to it. And I think it does speak at an interesting time with regard to space here in Scotland, where there is that sort of almost childhood excitement of rockets and satellites. But the reality is there are a significant number of jobs, as you've indicated, already exist for it. Just before I invite other members of the committee, can I just confirm, in essence, the extent of what you're covering with regard to space? I could then do the quote of the final frontier and it covering everything. But your interest is in both the launch site facilities, the launch facilities, but also the engineering behind the satellite production and all of the supply chain into that here in Scotland. Is that right?
That would be correct. I mean, we're taking a very wide focus at this point. In our early meetings, I would expect that the members will themselves indicate where they need to focus attention through the CPG in order to gain an awareness of the issues that are facing it. I know there's regulatory issues and so on, and part of these regulatory issues are with the Scottish Government, part are with the UK Government, and again, I think this link-up between the two different committees at the opposite ends will be really useful for lobbying for what's needed to make sure that this is a successful industry.
Thank you, that's very helpful. Do any other committee members have any questions? If I start at the far end there, Alexander.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Mr. Beattie, for a very good synopsis in your introduction about where you are in this process, and I think you have identified the gap in the market for the Parliament to be actively involved. But can I ask, what are your initial plans? You've got a huge amount of information and a huge amount of organisations there. How are you planning to try and streamline that so that you try and capture what is a very progressive industry to ensure that you're capturing what is required? Because, as I say, you've already identified that there's a massive market and there's a massive opportunity, but it's trying to streamline that to make sure the CPG does actually gain and benefit from that in its early existence.
Clearly, it's a huge industry and there is a limit to what a CPG can do. You're meeting four times a year, perhaps. I think there's two areas that we'd focus on as I see it now. One is the informational side, to make sure that MSPs are informed and understand the developments and what's happening. But also, and this will have to be something that we talk to the industry members about, where there's a weakness or where there are things we can do to lobby or persuade or you understand the limitations of a CPG, but we can raise to the surface where there are problems and glitches that we can maybe help with collectively.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Alison. Paul.
Thank you, Convener. I was interested in this cross-party group. I should declare an interest, though I haven't explored in any great detail. The Western Scotland Science Park is in my constituency of Maryhill and Springburn. We've got a number of companies who are actively involved in the space sector with technology and are very, very successful. So Maryhill has a footprint in space. That said, I may join this cross-party group if it's afforded recognition, but my time constraints are such that I wouldn't be taking on an office-bearing position, and I might come to an occasional meeting that is a particular constituency interest. So I get the time constraints that there are on MSPs. You're convener of three cross-party groups already. Become a convener of a fourth cross-party group is a significant time constraint. Do you feel you've got the time to commit to being convener of four cross-party groups?
I think that this cross-party group has already attracted a huge amount of attention and a huge amount of interest. And MSPs become engaged in different things for different reasons, partly because of their own interest, partly because of the interest of their constituents and so on. And I think that as far as this space CPG is concerned, the level of interest is probably the highest I've seen in a very, very long time. And you're talking about perhaps only having time to drop in on things that are related to constituency business and so on. That's absolutely fine. That would be encouraged.
To be fair, Mr. Beattie, I was talking about your time constraints rather than mine. You're the convener of three cross-party groups. This week you're the convener of a fourth one. Every potential cross-party group in the future is going to be asked very similar questions. It's nothing specific to yourself or this cross-party group, but four cross-party groups are quite a significant commitment to be convener of. Yeah. Do you feel you can give it the time it deserves?
I do. The industry members themselves are taking on the secretarial work and the admin work and so forth. They are providing all the support. So my office will be relatively not impacted. Yes, there will have to be input from the convener and hopefully from the active MSPs. But I'm absolutely certain I would not have gone into this if I didn't believe that I had the time to be able to commit to this. Right. And frankly, given the nature of what we're looking at, it's a priority. It's a priority for Scotland. It's a priority for the rest of the UK. And I think it would be a serious... I almost said space. It would be a serious deficiency in the range of CPGs that we're providing if this vital area wasn't covered.
Right. So let me follow up a little bit more on that. And I do know this will be your eighth cross-party group you'll be a member of if this one is accepted. Now, I convene two cross-party groups. They can provide lots of really good purposes. One purpose they can provide is they can really connect the sector in a way that they're maybe not necessarily connected, and the cross-party group can do that. So I'd like to know whether you feel the space industry is already well connected as a sector and an industry, whether you feel they've already got good links with government at all levels, be that local authorities, be that Scottish Government and UK Government. And the reason for asking those two questions is because earlier on your contribution you mentioned a bit of a serious deficiency if we didn't have this cross-party group, but also that where problems emerge, this could be a vehicle for tackling some of that. Can you give me an example of what those problems are? Or is everything tickety-boo at the moment? Well, what are the issues?
In the early stages of discussions when we were putting this group together, there was a couple of areas that were highlighted that were causing some issues. One was government policy, both north and south of the border, and the lack of clarification which would allow them to go forward and develop. Also, there were concerns about regulatory constraints, because the regulations are not moving as fast as the space industry is. So that really is a UK issue, which we would hope to highlight and link up with the APBG down in Westminster. So we need to have a joined-up approach on this, because you know a lot of these companies and so on that are signing up are operating north and south of the border. So we have to make sure this will be a little bit complicated at first until we can get it bedded in. But if we can make this work, the benefits to Scotland, I think, will be very significant. As you know, cross-party groups in themselves have no power, but they do have the power of being heard, publicity, making sure that people understand what the issues are. And, you know, as we know, government ministers and so on have been very generous in their time in coming into CPGs and talking to them and understanding those issues. Now, there are a lot of issues around this kind of CPG where you're dealing with different competing bodies, because some of them are competitors. I mean, I suspect Airbus and Lockheed Martin are not necessarily commercially joined at the hip. So there are these issues as well. But do you know something? A lot of that is for the participants who are pushing for this, and they are pushing for this. They see a value in this. So it's for them to work out those issues, if indeed they are issues. There are so many common issues, as I said, with regulation, with planning, with policy, that we can help focus that and bring it together. And it'll be so much more powerful if it can be done in tandem up here in Scotland and down in Westminster.
Convener, I'm glad that I pushed Mr... first of all, I apologise for ever using the expression tickety-boo in committee. Can we please strike that from the record forthwith? I'm glad I pushed you a little bit, Mr Beattie, on that, because that was the first time I heard you describe what issues, emerging issues there could be within the industry and sector where MSPs would want to be cited on that to take forward how we see fit on a cross-party group basis to deal with some of those in relation to clarity of government policy both in Scotland and the UK and in relation to the regulatory regime. We're starting to hit upon things where there could be a real public interest in pushing forward within this Parliament's cross-party group system. So I'm pleased I push a little bit on that, Mr Beattie, but that gives me a lot more certainty about the benefit of this cross-party group. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. If there are no further questions from the committee, can I thank you for attending this morning, Colin Beattie? The committee will consider whether to approve the application at agenda item 3, and the clerks will inform you of the committee's decision in due course. But can I thank you for coming today?
Thank you.
And now, indeed, if we move, to agenda item 3. It is for the committee to consider whether or not to accord recognition to the proposed cross-party group on space. Are there any comments before I formally put the question? Bob?
A general comment. Can you hear if that's okay? Mm-hmm. Again, it's a bit unfair on Mr Beattie, but my last line of questioning was quite important, because before that I was getting the picture of a powerful, dynamic and growing industry within Scotland and the UK, which is great news. And I'd been a little bit unclear what the benefit for Parliament would be. I could see what the benefit for the sector would be, but it's a parliamentary cross-party group, and we got towards the end of the exchange, I could see what the benefit for Parliament would be, other than just being informed. So Mr Beattie's kind of outlined some of that. We're not very good at a Parliament from year to year actually auditing some of this to see if cross-party groups actually then fulfil what their aspirations actually were. That's not specific to this proposed cross-party group, but it maybe feeds in, convener, to a discussion we may have later on in this meeting about cross-party groups more generally. And I just wanted to put that on the record, given that we've just discussed this particular cross-party group. Some really quite significant ambitions, which I commend, but with all cross-party groups, maybe we have to look a little bit more carefully about whether they actually fulfil what they're seeking to set out to fulfil when they come to here or to this committee to seek recognition.
Well, you certainly anticipate a later agenda item with that, so can I thank you, Bob. Edward?
Just to put on record, as I do every time we consider a cross-party group, is the number of cross-party groups in this Parliament, but I know we're coming on to that. But I just will continue to say it till I believe we've resolved the issue, which I don't think we have yet, convener.
That's very helpful. Well, if there are no other comments, can I put the formal question? Are we going to acquiesce recognition to this proposed cross-party group? Are we in agreement? We are. Excellent. Thank you. Agenda item 4 is in relation to correspondence that we've received from Graham Day, MSP. In his correspondence, he raises a number of concerns about parliamentary motions and how they're being used, and in particularly those that congratulate individuals or organisations. Does any members of the committee have any comments on that? Edward.
Kamina, can I just say that in the 6 years that I've been in Parliament, I have noticed exactly the same thing. I have also noticed the amount of time it takes for motions to be approved and come back through from the Parliament, which would suggest that there is a problem not only in resourcing it, possibly in funding it, but actually the number of motions. And it has changed. In the past, it was to congratulate groups and organisations. And I'm not saying it's got to the level of this, but we are, in some cases, almost at the level of congratulating somebody for baking a cake or doing other things. And I wonder if that's what the system was proposed. So I think we do need to look at this. I think it would be very helpful to have views from people who've been in the Parliament for longer than me to see if they notice, and Graham Day may be that person to come and give evidence to the committee.
That's very helpful. Colette, and then I'll come to you, Alexander.
Thanks, convener. And can I kind of flip this round in terms of motions? And I agree with Edward in terms of the length of time it takes to put a motion for or for to get it, you know, approved. However, one of the things, and I'm going to link this to CPG, which is absolutely relevant today, and that I'm a member of the CPG for medicinal cannabis. And it affects a constituency of mine, and that I actually, given the evidence that came forward at the CPG for that, I actually put a motion forward, and I got such strong support for it. It was the first time I was able to put on a member's debate in the chamber, which was really effective, and I think it is evidence that that is how effective CPGs work. Mm-hmm. But equally, in terms of motions as well, taking that forward in what we're doing, but equally, that some of the motions that are coming forward are particularly, you know, weak. And I strongly agree with Edward on that. And, you know, I agree with Graham in his letter as well.
Mm-hmm. It's very helpful. Alexander?
I think Graham Day makes some very valid points, convener, about the structure, the type, but I also acknowledge what others have said, that having motions is a great opportunity to highlight some very worthwhile causes, and you know we just have to look sometimes at the amount of information that is transmitted, and it is a way to recognise an individual or an organisation at a level within a region or a constituency, as well as locally, regionally or nationally. But I do acknowledge the fact that there seems to be an erosion of some of that. And I think that in trying to bring things to a better conclusion for everybody, so that there is a level of standard or there's an area that people would expect to be always potentially putting forward, but there's also an area that is now going below the bar if a bar has to be produced or met to suggest that would be what we would expect, but something of a nature would not. I think would be useful to be guided for staff and for MSPs, because in reality, 9 times out of 10, it may be a staff member who's putting together some of the motions on behalf of the member himself or herself. And I think that needs to be... So there's a bit of training required when it comes to what researchers and communications officers or managers within the Parliament are trying to do as well. So I think all of those need to be looked at this process. And if we can capture that, it would be easier then to manage the process for everybody.
I think that's very helpful. Bob?
Thanks, convener. I think Mr. Day has dared to put on record in the public domain something that many MSPs have been thinking for some time. That said, some MSPs that have been thinking that for some time may also be, and guilty is the wrong expression to use, guilty of,
of putting motions down, as Mr. Luton said, about someone who wins a contest for baking a cake. Well, I can tell you he's never tasted my cookery. That won't be subject to any of those motions. However, Mr. Gray makes a serious point, but there's always unintended consequences, Convener. This Parliament needs to find a way about how we shine a light on remarkable people at all levels of society who do something worthwhile and deserve to be commended, be it in this Parliament or elsewhere. That said, that doesn't always have to be through a conventional parliamentary motion. And I know there are other members in this place who have got ideas about various ways that parliamentarians, be those constituency or regional MSPs, could use parliamentary mechanisms to shine a light on the remarkable people in our constituencies that we'll represent who deserve to be recognised. That would always be through a parliamentary motion, but there should be a mechanism. So if we are going to review this, I think we should bear in mind that we have to do it in a way that doesn't block opportunities for members of this Parliament to recognise remarkable people, irrespective of whether that is a substantial thing at a regional or national level, are a very small micro-local thing that makes a real difference to their community. So, with that in mind, I'm keen for us to look at this in greater detail and see what other ideas are out there amongst parliamentarians and others. But I would just add one thing. If we are going to look at parliamentary motions, we might want to look at another aspect of the changing nature of parliamentary motions. When I was first elected in this place in 2007, motions that were taken for members' debate tended to be consensual or thought-provoking and challenging, but very rarely tribal and playing out entrenched party positions. I get a feeling, Convener, that in the last few years, motions for debate have been much more entrenched at times, much more tribal at times, and much more opportunities for some MSPs to play out entrenched party positions. And I don't think that was ever the intention of members' debates. And it's motions that are lodged in Parliament that are then taken forward for members' debates. We should look at the totality of motions lodged in this place if we're going to look at this in more detail. Finally, Convener, there's some wonderful members' debates out there where you get a fantastic debate and a great dynamic and thought-provoking ideas between members of all parties, and we shouldn't restrict that vibrant debate. But there has been a tendency for tribalised debates in the chamber, in members' debates, and that, I don't think, was the original intention. I think we should look at the thing, look at motions and debates in the round.
Edward, do you want to...
Sorry, can I just agree with Bob in the sense that I've noticed a far more tribal approach to motions, and the motions that actually are interesting are the ones that you choose to speak in because you want to inform yourself about it. So there's issues that I have no idea, but have volunteered to speak in it because it informs me about things that are going on. Those are the motions that are useful. They are the motions that highlight important things in the Parliament. I agree with Bob, though, that there are motions that come which are purely political in members' debates, which may be wrong, and I think it is wrong, but probably shows frustration about the lack of ability to debate these in normal parliamentary time. So I think it is a wider inquiry. I think it is wrong, or I don't believe it's the reason for motions to have a political debate. It's to inform debate and to celebrate and to, in some cases, in other cases, just to inform us of things that are going on. So I would echo Bob's views, and I think a wider inquiry into all of those things with costings would be important, because we all know that, you know, sometimes you settle down in the evening at 9 o'clock and then you get a whole heap of motions flooding into your inbox, usually six from one person just in the evening. And I'm not saying they're meaningless, but, you know, to flood somebody's email box with six motions in the evening on sometimes quite minor issues is not the way to get parliamentarians informed or involved in processes.
And I think that I think all of those contributions are incredibly helpful. And I think that Graham Day's letter, for which I do thank him, is speaking very specifically about the motions that are just seeking MSP support rather than those that are intended to go forward for a members' debate. But I am cognizant of what members have said, that this seems to have been not unspoken, but a quietly spoken concern of a number of MSPs. And I think there's an agreement in the committee to look at this further. Would the committee be content for a short paper to be drafted seeking costings information so that we can perhaps place a parameter around what the sort of inquiry would be? And I noted the comment about seeking the wisdom of more experienced members who sat over a number of sessions to, at the very least, subjectively give us their experiences of the change in motions and debate would be helpful. So are we content to ask for a paper to be prepared and we can consider this at a subsequent meeting? Yes. Excellent. I'm very grateful for that. Our next item, agenda item 5, is to consider the annual update on the cross-party group compliance with the Code of Conduct. Members will have received the paper which looks back at the cross-party groups over the period of time in which each cross-party group that this committee has afforded recognition to has been green, yellow, red or blue coded for the variety of requirements that are needed for them to comply with the rules. Would anyone like to kick off with comment, discussion or opinion on what they have looked at?
I don't want to kick off. I maybe try and give some reasoned discussion on this. You know, ever since I've been a member of this committee, I've always voiced my concerns about the amount of work that cross-party groups require from MSPs. And some MSPs, in trying to support groups, take on a huge amount of CPG responsibilities. And some feel pressurised into doing that, and I think new members, without knowing, sometimes may get themselves into the situation where they are on several cross-party groups and they're not able to give any of them their full attention. So looking at this chart in front of me and in front of the committee is extremely interesting, and the vast majority of people, cross-party groups, are green-lighted, if that's a right description, for complying with the requirements. But there are a significant amount of groups that have, in some cases, one yellow warning light, in some cases more than one yellow warning light, and in some cases a red stoplight, and in some cases more than one red stoplight. So using the analogies that are in here, I think we need to do a further piece of work on looking at how to resolve this. But my gut feeling looking on this, that if I saw a group with two red lights, there would be a very clear indication in my mind that one should question whether the cross-party group is fulfilling its role. And if there was two yellow lights and a red light, that would also fulfil that same criteria. I don't propose to go through the list. People can look at it themselves and make their own decisions. But my view is that I believe the committee has a role in helping cross-party groups decide whether they have a future or whether they don't have a future. And we should be quite forthright in our questioning and as a committee and encourage. But if we can't encourage people to fulfil their requirements or cross-party groups to fulfil their requirements, we should suggest to them that they don't fulfil the requirements and they should drop out. Now, I don't want this to be seen, and I'd like it on record, that I am against all cross-party groups. I am fundamentally not. I'm a convener of two cross-party groups and I give it my entire attention and I work hard on those cross-party groups, as a lot of MSPs do. But 3, 4, 5, in some cases 10 cross-party groups, could I be on those? I struggle, Convener, and I'll perhaps leave it there.
That's helpful. Alexander, can I come to you?
Thank you, Convener. As Edward already has indicated, I mean, time is precious for MSPs, but the need to have cross-party groups, we've already spoke on this on a number of occasions in the past, and there are some very worthwhile. And it's obviously a great opportunity to ensure that this building and this Parliament recognises and supports many organisations and individuals. And that's good. But there is an issue when it comes to workforce, timing, the focus of the groups and parliamentary business all have an impact on all of these cross-party groups. And I myself, I am a co-convener of three, and I know how much time that takes up to ensure that I can manage to balance my work-life balance within this building to ensure that I do that. But I am definitely concerned at the number of orange and red that appear on this document, because that once again is a red light to us as a committee that there's a problem. And the problem may well be that it's time, work, focus and parliamentary business that are affecting all of that. It may well be that the cross-party group has run its course and it needs to be rethought if it is to continue. And I think that's important, that we maybe do analyse some of them and their focus and what type of procedures they have if it has now got to the stage. And there's also the discussion about how many cross-party groups have an overbalance with one another, and that can dilute. So maybe we don't need three that talk on one area, but one that maybe does this specifically. So I think this has been a very useful document for us to see, but I think there's a lot more work to be done, convener, to ensure that we get the best out of this. Because, as I say, I am a great supporter of cross-party groups, as many are, but they need to be relevant, they need to be progressive, and they also need to be fulfilling the standard that we set at this committee and within this Parliament. And if they're not doing that, then they need to be looked at.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bob, can I come to you?
Yeah. Thank you, convener. Clearly, I made some comments to Mr. Beattie earlier on in the meeting. I felt a little bit guilty about that, because I've got a very direct constituent's interest in cross-party group and space being successful in this Parliament, given the employment it creates, the dynamic there is in my constituency for the space sector, and that industry is a real growing sector. But I just wanted to challenge and push a little bit in relation to whether we should approve that cross-party group, not because it's a cross-party group in space, but because there's been a feeling for years now, before this particular committee was in post, that it was a conveyor belt to acceptance and compliance for cross-party groups, and that's just how it's always been. Well, clearly that's got to stop now. There's got to be some new structures put in place, and can I commend the clerking team for providing this diagram, this visual aid, to letting us know what's going on across all the cross-party groups in the Parliament. We probably have to build up additional structures around how we scrutinise the compliance of cross-party groups in this place, and just be consistent and systematic as to how we approach it within the Parliament, so that one cross-party group does not feel it's been unfairly targeted over others for lack of compliance. So if we can just have a little bit of a review of how this is monitored in the Parliament, how cross-party groups are not compliant or supported to be compliant, or whether those slightly more challenging conversations about, well, has a group effectively fallen into abeyance, and is this the best way forward to, and I hate this expression, to limp on, rather than reconsolidate your efforts as MSPs about the best use of your time.
I think that's very helpful, and I think it's right to say that there are a significant number of the CPGs that have complied with their regulatory requirements, and there are indeed CPGs that haven't got to the stage where they would have been expected to do their annual return, but have complied with all of the requirements. We have already withdrawn recognition from one CPG this year in relation to a failure to meet with the requirements that are there, and that is contained in this report. And I wonder whether, actually, for the purposes of the annual review, the committee would be content for me as convener to write to all of the groups, those that have complied, simply to say thank you for complying, those that have not, to highlight where they have fallen short with, and they will be cognizant of what we have said today, with the outcomes that could follow unless they can first rectify their regulatory failure. It's interesting, Mr. Beattie talking about regulatory requirements, comply with their regulatory requirements, and or explain why they have been unable, because I know there's been a number of events that have had to be cancelled because of other chamber commitments. But if the committee is happy for me to do that, I think it is a way to take this, and I echo your comments, Bob, this excellent piece of work, which I would draw attention to all CPGs to look at to see how they are doing. It is very quick to find your own individual CPG that you're involved in and to see how it's been complied with. Are we content with... Oh, Edward, I'd like to say.
Sorry, Convener, I totally agree. I mean, could it, in that letter you be quite firm to say that we continue to look at it? And could I say that you might also offer them the opportunity, if they haven't complied, to consider whether they may wish to withdraw the CPG, because it is really difficult as an MSP, once you get tied into this, to say, maybe this isn't working. Mm-hmm. So if you give them the opportunity, that might be useful to some of the members on those groups.
I think that's very helpful, and to echo Bob's pressing questions to Colin Beattie. There is a obligation on the MSPs themselves to do this, and sometimes we may need to help MSPs even from themselves. And certainly I will put in that should the CPG have come to the end of what it sought to achieve, then it is possible to write to us to be, in essence, de-recognised and remove the obligations. Bob?
Thank you, Convener. I didn't say my contributions. I'm real pleased that you did. Most cross-party groups are compliant,
yeah,
and meet all their... all the requirements, and maybe that was a little bit lost in my comments. I'm pleased that you put that on the record. I suspect most cross-party is compliant because they have exceptional secretariats supporting them, by and large, unpaid, doing sterling work. And I think that's important to recognise as well. So I think we're agreeing to write to conveners. I don't know if it's appropriate to also write to the convener and the associated secretariat with said same correspondence. And this is a horrible thing to say, convener, but I want to make sure that the secretariats are cited on these matters at the earliest opportunity, particularly if a cross-party group is not compliant.
I think that is common sense at its best. I will be writing to the convener because they're the individual who has undertaken to comply with this as an MSP. But of course it makes sense to ensure that the secretariat where they're identified are also aware, because of the good work that a lot of the secretariats do. And I think at the end of the day, we have, as a committee, almost from day one, been concerned about CPGs. It is something that is discussed by MSPs. They do fulfil, at their very best, an incredibly valuable function within this Parliament, allowing people of Scotland, industries of Scotland, charities of Scotland, third sector of Scotland, communities of Scotland to reach out and speak to specific MSPs to seek their help and assistance, or indeed just to give them information. But I think this annual report shows there are warning lights on the dashboard, and it would be wrong for us to ignore those. So if we're happy to do that, I will write to all of the CPGs, a variety of correspondence, first congratulating those that have complied with it and those that have not, along with their supporting secretariat, seeking an explanation and an undertaking to put right the defects as soon as possible. Are we content with that?
Yes,
excellent. Well, with that, I will now move the meeting into private.